An experience about building application in SharePoint, specifically with the SharePoint framework, relatively new pattern of development in SharePoint. I'm a SharePoint MVP for Microsoft, so my social coordinates online if you want to get in touch. And that's the agenda for today. So introducing the SharePoint framework, what it is, why now, what is beneficial for SharePoint developers, and then getting more into the hot topic of the day, so building a solid application using TypeScript. The SharePoint framework is built on top of TypeScript. And then obviously we'll play a bit with some demos, we'll build a web part using the SharePoint framework itself. Right, okay. Now, let's give some context. So I'm pretty sure that all of you, if you're working with SharePoint, have heard about the SharePoint framework. It's been around probably for a year or so, but where is it coming from? It's coming from an evolution of development in SharePoint that is taking SharePoint on-premises and SharePoint online in Office 365 towards a completely new model. If you think of SharePoint 10 years ago, 2007, right? We couldn't do very much in terms of programming, except we have to develop an application in .NET, in C Sharp, create a full trust with the server, and publish on the server. So there was no cloud at that time, there was no SharePoint online, we were only publishing an application hosting on the SharePoint server itself. So you will bind the libraries into your project, make a create a reference, a full trust, deploy, and everything will work. Great, but extreme limitation, because you can only work by deploying your custom application in the SharePoint server itself. 3 years passed, and we went into SharePoint 2010, which introduced the client-side object model, as in C-sharp, but on the client side. So no need to install the application on the server itself. It also introduced the REST API, so we could do any application in JavaScript, and it did also introduce the JavaScript object model, which is a way of talking to SharePoint using a common library and having access to documents, list items, and so on. Still some limitation though. Where are the limitations? The limitation is you still need to have a reference to some specific libraries, objects that you need in order to communicate with SharePoint itself. So Microsoft evolved a bit. And in 2013, every year something new, introduced the app model, or the add-in, how they call it now. Initially, they call it app, because they were thinking, oh, this is the new Microsoft App Store, and SharePoint will have all the apps in there. They changed a bit. Now everything that is inside Office and Office 365 is an add-in. So they introduced the app model. Here's a big challenge, though. When you develop an app for SharePoint or an add-in, it runs in an iframe. So it runs in the same context of the application, but is isolated. It works aside, like a web part that works in another frame. And it's not very responsive, obviously, so it creates a bit of challenge of security and so on. And here we are. We are in 2016 now. Well, Microsoft has also announced SharePoint 2019 already, so you see the pattern every 3 years they're doing something. But with SharePoint 2016 came the SharePoint framework, or SPFX for friends. Now, SharePoint framework is a completely JavaScript framework, but it's built on top of TypeScript, and we will see in a moment why. And it provides a good number of advantages. So what is it, first of all? It's a framework for building pages and web parts completely dynamically, completely client-side, so no need to deploy anything on the server side of the SharePoint server, and it does run into the same page context. So it's not in an iframe, it's not in isolation, when it, the page the, or the code of the web part is generated, it will be part of the entire page itself. So it is part of the DOM, which means that it's completely responsive and is based, as we will see in a moment, on open source libraries. So Microsoft took a shift from where traditionally development in SharePoint was based on some templates in Visual Studio, and it did require using C# or IIS server for deploying. We moved a completely different tool set, and we'll play with that in a moment. What else? Yes, so it works for web parts, so you can build a web part in SharePoint using the SharePoint framework, but also with extensions. So you can modify, for example, the ribbon or make some other changes to the layout of SharePoint that are outside of the context of the page itself. If you are familiar with the latest version of SharePoint, you probably know that they now have a new modern theme. And it used to be classic, it is now modern, or actually you can work with both. SharePoint framework both works with classic and modern style, and it works, well, first with the online version. So it's meant to be used with SharePoint Online. But in SharePoint 2016, with the feature pack 2, you can also use the SharePoint framework on premises. So I mentioned a couple of times already that there are some tools that have changed. All right, quickly here. Basically, what used to be the typical tool set of development in C# using Visual Studio, then building with MS Build, then deploying with a NuGet package, and then publishing to your web server, typically on IIS. Now it's completely different. Well, mostly different. So first of all, from a language perspective, we say no more C#, we do everything in TypeScript. And TypeScript eventually turns into a JavaScript, but we don't know, we don't care. We program in TypeScript. What else? We're not using Visual Studio any longer, although you may want. There are different other tools. From Microsoft itself, Visual Studio Code, but you can use Notepad, really. It is as simple as that. For making life a bit easier, though, you want to start with a template of a document, of a project. So you don't really want to start from scratch. Which means that Yeoman is your friend, because Yeoman will create a template for building your web part using the SharePoint framework. And when you build it with Gulp. And then Gulp will bundle all the resources, all the JavaScript, the CSS, everything that you need in a package. And then obviously you can deploy on your SharePoint server. So that's a bit of the framework itself. Let's make a quick demo how to build a web part in a SharePoint framework very, very easily using all these open source tools. So let me now switch off the slides and go into Visual Studio Code. I'm using Code just because I'm more familiar with it, but really you can use WebStorm from JetBrains, you can use Atom. There are different web editors that are perfect for SharePoint framework. All right, so what do we need? Well, we need a folder, first of all. So let me do that. I open my Node.js command prompt. Let me zoom in a bit so that it's slightly more visible. Otherwise, it's going to be tricky for you guys to see from a distance. All right, so I have a folder here, SharePoint framework. Let's create a Hello Kiev web part. Okay, oops, web part. Where is my P? Here it is. And then I'll get in. All right. So that's my starting point. Now I want to start, well, I could start from scratch, but it would take some good time. I can start from a template. A template of a SharePoint framework web part. And who is your friend for templating is Yeoman. So we'll do something like this. Yeoman at Microsoft/SharePoint. Oops. Spelling. SharePoint. That's all you need. So Yeoman, we start building your SharePoint app, web part with all the files that you need. And we'll ask a few questions. What is the solution name? Hello Kiv web part. I'm happy with that. Are you targeting SharePoint Online or SharePoint 2016, so the server version? Let's go for the online version only. Create a subfolder, use the current folder, yes. Do you want to allow the tenant admin something about security, yes. Web part or an extension, we're building a web part because we want to display in the page. What is the web part name? Well, it's not Hello World, but is Hello Kiev, right? Description, welcome to beautiful Kiev. All right, so now choice of a JavaScript framework. You wanna do React, Knockout, potentially you can do Angular, although it's not in the option, or completely no JavaScript framework. Now, at this stage, I'm gonna keep it simple and say no JavaScript framework. When do you normally use one of these other frameworks? If you're doing some data binding. So, but because we're keeping simple, because we don't have really a lot of time today, but we're keeping no JavaScript framework, and that's it. So we start creating all this template, and Yeoman will do it in less than a minute, hopefully. And once it's done, we have all the files that we need to start creating our first web part. So it is slightly a different approach. In Visual Studio, probably you will go into Visual Studio, add project, choose one of the different templates, and then start working on it. It's a bit of a command prompt. And as you can see, the tool is npm here. So instead of working with NuGet packages, now we work with npm. All right, let's see. As soon as this is done, we can open the solution in Visual Studio Code, and I can deploy it and see how that runs. What else is important to know? Well, first of all, you need a Node.js server running on your dev environment. So we need Node.js to be installed, because Node.js will basically run your JavaScript server side, and it will make the communication with SharePoint. Okay, still deploying a few files. There are a few files, to be honest. I think at the end, each basic template contains around 32,000 files. It's quite a lot for just a web part, but that's it, really. There are quite a good number of files that are created, some progress. Here we go. All done. All right. Now, let me open this. Hello, Kiev. Open the folder. And hopefully it's good enough. You can see here, source, web part, and we have some TS files, or some TypeScript file. Now, without going too much into details right now, because we'll do it later, this is all you need to care for now. There is a class that is called Hello Kiev Web Part that contains a render method, and the render method defines the HTML that we want to display in the web part. Let's take it for good. For now, we're not doing any changes, so I need to deploy it. I want to deploy it. So who is your friend for deploying? Is Gulp. All right, so back to the command prompt. We do something like this. Well, first of all, my dev environment is not certified, it's not safe. I need a developer certificate. And then I can deploy. So everything runs on HTTPS by default. So I need to do something like this. Gulp. Trust dev cert. This will install a certification a certificate that trusts the source as this environment, and then deploy gulp serve. That's it. Now, when deploying, gulp will open the browser. Here we go. And we'll open the browser at this local host URL in a workbench. What is the workbench? It's a simulation of SharePoint. So this is like SharePoint Online, but we are not online. We are on localhost. You're running from my laptop in this case. So you're running on your dev environment. And we are simulating adding a web part. Here it is. Can you see that? It's the Hello Kiev web part that we have just deployed. And it looks like this. Now, if we were to make a change, I will go here. Welcome to SharePoint. We can change it to Welcome to Kiev. Save, go back, refresh, and here it is. Okay, simple as that, obviously. You have some good web designers in your company, they can build something nice, they can give you the HTML, and then you can put it there into the web part. That's all for now. Let's carry on a bit, because I will come back to the web part after introducing some of the solid principles, which basically how we can make these SharePoint framework apps better with TypeScript. And then we'll see how this web part can be a bit smarter. So not just displaying static text, but taking text dynamically from SharePoint itself. All right, so I'm gonna kill this for now. That is all done. Close the solution. And a few more slides, and then I'll come back to the live demo. All right, so I mentioned TypeScript. TypeScript is the language for the SharePoint framework. We briefly have seen a TS file that contains a class, a web part, and a render method. So why Microsoft decided to use TypeScript for the SharePoint framework? Well, there are some good reasons. One is, as someone in this room will say, a JavaScript developer is an oxymoron. So if you are a JavaScript, or you may not be really a developer. But jokes aside, TypeScript lets you be an object-oriented programming developer, which is important in SharePoint because SharePoint is strongly typed. So when you define a list in SharePoint, and you define that there is an ID is type GUID. You define a title is a string. You define a date and is a date time. JavaScript, as you probably know, is loosely typed. I can put anything in there in a variable and will still be good. TypeScript will enforce this type control during development, because if I publish something in SharePoint and the type of my object doesn't match with the SharePoint list item, it will break, it will fail, actually. But still, TypeScript compiles everything in JavaScript. So everything that we do in terms of object-oriented programming or type checking is done by TypeScript and compiled into JavaScript for compatibility with different other browsers. Now, where do I want to get from this? I want to get to a point to try to, not convince you, but prove that TypeScript is a good approach for the SharePoint framework. And it does so because it helps to resolve the five challenges of the five principles of developing solid applications. And we could talk about all these for hours and hours, but we'll try really to make it more practical. So instead of being very academic, no, and say what is the single responsibility principle, why is good, why is not, or maybe let's try to give a few examples and make sure that we all appreciate how TypeScript helps to differentiate between an object and a contract, so between a class and an interface. How can it help to create polymorphism or inheritance, all nice principles of object-oriented programming that fits very well in the SharePoint framework. So I'm gonna do a couple of things here. First is typical code smells. So typical, not mistakes, but smells in the sense of opportunities for improvement. So something that we could make it better, and it still works, but it doesn't really make our software scalable or beautiful or maintainable. So for example, objects that are tightly coupled to each other, where there is a strong dependency. Typically in JavaScript, when you start working with a very procedural approach, you try to bundle everything in there, one function after the other one. There is really no big difference what is a function, what is an object, what is an interface, what is a contract. So you start getting very, very coupled between all the different objects. And the types we said, loosely defined, and in general we have a poor object-oriented experience. So what a few examples, just to show in practice what I mean. And I'm very sure that all of you are familiar with this already, but just to make sure that we are all on the same page here. We have an object, and I'm calling this is a person with a couple of properties, a name and a say name that is my function. So I will probably do something like person name is Stefano, and then I will do something person, say the name, right? And then I can run this, and this should show my name in there. Here it is, done. Now, what if we have another person? Okay, so if we have another person, I will say, now, do I want to define another person like this? It would be really silly, right? It's a lot of duplication of code. So how can I reuse this object in a way that is reusable? Because this is a singleton at the end. It's an object that it defines only once. Well, probably I will do something like person2 equal person, which is a bit bizarre to read. But then name will be Julia. And person2 say the name. So then refresh this, and I should have here we go. All both name displayed. Okay, so seems all right, it works, but there is a smell here, first of all, because I'm combining objects that don't really belong to each other. So probably a better way would be, okay, but let's be more object-oriented. So we'll probably create something, how did I call it, person, yes. Function, person, and then I'll say there is a name, and there is a function. Let me just do copy and paste, otherwise it will take me too long to type. There is a name and there is a say name as well. Okay, so then it will work super well because I can do person one, new person, right? And then do something like this, again with Stefano, and p1 dot say the name. And that obviously will display the name. And if I have a P2, P3, P4, so I can start duplicating objects. So this is a bit more object-oriented, start making sense. But what happens if I do something like this? It will display a number, and probably it doesn't make sense. No one is checking that 2017 is a number and not a name. You get the message, right? I mean, I'm pretty sure that if you work with JavaScript, you know already these challenges. And also, you see there is a very strong dependency here. The console is part of the sayName method. What if I want to write on a file? What if I want to what if I want to display in an HTML page? So then probably I will need to do something like write name or display name. So start duplicating instead of reusing functionality. So I start getting tightly coupled to the console object. There is no polymorphism, and it's not really object-oriented. So we all know a bit of these challenges. How TypeScript helps to resolve them? Well, TypeScript, first of all, it is object-oriented in the meaning that we have a class and we have an interface. So we can actually write our object in this way, as a class. Class person, name, or type string, say the name. Still, we have this dependency. That's fine for now, because this means that I can do something like P1 is a new person. Person. And then I can do p1.name, and then I can do obviously p1 say the name. And that obviously will display the name, but it starts getting a bit more object-oriented because I'm talking as a class. If I try to put here 2017, I'll get an error. I say type 2017 is not assignable to type string. So I have a type control. So you start getting a bit more in line with what we expected. What else? We also have interfaces. So I want to resolve this problem. I don't want to have a console tightly coupled to my sayName method. I want to abstract this. So again, apologies, a bit of copy and paste to make it quicker. So I create an interface. And I call it iWriter, and this interface will say any message. Then I will create an object. I'll create an object that is my console writer that implements this interface, and then it will say this on the console. If I want to write to a file, I will do something similar as a file writer or a HTML writer. Okay, so I start then working by contract. So iWriter is my contract. So how does this change? It changes in this way. Writer is a type writer, and then this will simply say the name. And instead of doing this, I will need to inject the dependency and do something like this. Right, so you're probably familiar with this pattern, right? Nothing revolutionary here. But what it is happening here that I'm not creating a dependency between my class person and the console, but I'm creating an abstraction between the person and whatever is the writer that will eventually produce the output on console, on file, on HTML page, and whatever. And I'm injecting this dependency at runtime in the same name. Now, this is the concept of the dependency injection. That is one of the principles that we have in the solid principles. Let me go one here, the D. So create this dependent, break the dependency between two objects. And can be done in different ways. This is an injection in the method. You can inject the dependency in the constructor. You can inject the dependency in the property. But to keep it simple, that was just an example of how TypeScript can help with that. And so I like to turn what is a code smell in a code scent. So something that is nice, where we have loosely coupled objects. So person and console, they're not tied together because a person is a person. We don't have to write necessarily on a console. I can write somewhere else. And I like that it's strongly typed. I can't write 2017 in the name. It has to be a string. And I can implement all the nice principles of object-oriented programming. So there is abstraction from the specific writer, there is the reusable of the sayName method with different output, and so on. Okay, so start making a bit of sense. Now, it's funny, because when I was thinking, but why, as a developer, no, my background is as a developer, we tend to write code smells more easily than code scents. Are we lazy? Are we just have no time? Because it does happen very, very frequently. Irrespective of the experience, if whether you are a developer for a year or 15 years, you typically go back to making code written in that way, because it's probably quicker. But then I thought, as a human person, actually, there are a lot of situations in real life that represent code smells. So, a couple of things, just for fun. If you check in a cheap hotel, very likely you will find something on the left here, like an hair dryer that is tightly coupled to the wall, and you can't move it around. You have to dry your hair there necessarily, and if the unit breaks, you can't replace it. I mean, you have to call someone to go and replace completely the unit, and then you have a new hair dryer. But the device, the unit, works only for one purpose, for one place only. A better approach, probably, obviously, is that you have a movable hair dryer where you can plug into the wall, into the power outlet. Now, that is a loosely coupled, because the power, you can use it also for other form of devices. So it's a better design. Think also of the solid principles. A hair clipper, if you have only one trimmer, you will be able to cut your hair only of one size. So it will be a closed device. But by having multiple trimmers of different size, the unit is closed, meaning that it will only be used for cutting your hair. Right? So it's closed to change, but it's open to enhancement. You can do different hair size by just playing with the different trimmers of different size. How about the risk of substitution? If you have an object that is implementing a parent functionality, and then you replace with a child object that inherit from the parent, you shouldn't expect any change. But in this case, it looks like a duck. It quacks like a duck, but it needs battery. So probably you have the wrong level of abstraction here. So you can't replace a real duck with a toy duck. Although there are a lot of things in common. So that is the risk of substitution. We tend to make mistakes by, in real life, inevitably. So this is my justification on why we tend to write code that eventually doesn't respond to all the nice principles of being solid, object-oriented programming. And this is why TypeScript can help to be a bit more structured as a developer, working in that direction. So let's complete now with this demo by writing a web part, trying to apply as much as possible the solid principles also to SharePoint. All right, so I'm gonna go back now. I'm not starting all over again with the Yeoman and Gulp because otherwise it will take too long. But I have already the solution ready. I already have the solution ready. And it will be also on GitHub if you fancy playing with it and see the source code. So first of all, how it looks like. I have my environment here. I want to show you first how that looks like, and then we can see the source code for it. So I'm in SharePoint. I'm in SharePoint Online. I have a list, and this list contains a few quotes. Okay, so there is just a title: "Don't cry because it's over, smile because it happened," and a few other quotes. As simple as that. So I want display. I want to display these quotes in a web page. So I go to my page, to my site page. I add a new page. I call these popular quotes, and then I add my web part, which I forgot to change the name when I deploy it, so it's still called Hello World, but that's my a solid Hello World, as you can see. Here it is. Oops, something went wrong. Yes, because I forgot to run. Human. I need to do this, no human, gulp, like this. I'll come back on this in a moment. Let's run it first and then tell you what's happening on the back end. Okay, it's running. So let me save and open this page again. Popular quotes, hopefully that will work. No, it doesn't, all right. So let's try and see what went wrong. All right, so this web part will basically show all the quotes. How does it work? Well, first of all, similarly to what we have seen before, we have our TypeScript file that contains the Hello World class, and the Hello World class, so we are in TypeScript here, as a render method with all the HTML. I've done only a few changes to display the title of the website in SharePoint, so I can see immediately when I publish whether I am in the development site or in the online, in the production site. And then there is a new container here, so as you can see, they're all divs, a new containers that displays the quotes. So I get the quotes and then I display in there. So I want to do this in a way that is nicely solid, object-oriented. So the difference is when I publish on my development environment, I don't want to have the dependency on SharePoint because I don't have SharePoint on my development environment, but I do have when I publish the application, my web part online. So I want to create a situation where when I'm running locally, I use some mock object, some mock quotes, some fake ones, and when I'm in SharePoint, I'm actually taking from the real list. So I need a couple of contracts, or probably three, more than a couple. I need an interface to define all the list items. And the list items is only a title. Obviously, the more complex is your list, then the more attributes you will have here. And then I have an interface for, so a contract for getting all the items from the list. But it will be different whether I am in my dev environment or in the cloud, in the online environment. So the actual implementation is basically that my SPList reader implements the interface and display all the items from the web part context. So it will do get context, all the list, get the list by title, display all the items. We go display all the items here, and then return this list of items. So this is basically how to get data from SharePoint directly. And then I have some mock quotes which extend my list reader, but instead of getting data from SharePoint, I will actually get some static hard-coded values. Because I'm on a dev environment, I'm mocking data for unit testing. I don't need to get into the real SharePoint. So you can see now the structure. I have some interfaces, so interface separation, single concern, because the one object does one thing only, and then all the aspect of object-oriented programming with the reader that works against the interface and these that inherit from the parent one. So one back here, I go into my contract at this place. So to run this application, I need to run gulp as we did before, right? Gulp server. Sorry, I'm in the wrong. This is why it didn't work. I'm in the wrong folder. This is solid something. Here we go. Gulp server. Gulp server is your deploy. Basically, it's now deploying the application. I was still in the previous folder in the Hello Kiev web part. All right, here it is. So it's opening the workbench on my local host. This is a simulation of SharePoint. So I am locally. It will open, add the hello world. My mock quotes are here. But now I want to package this application and deploy to SharePoint. So I'll do that by going into my SharePoint admin site. So now I'm in the real thing. I'm online. Apps. App catalog, apps for SharePoint is already there, but otherwise you would just have to take this file, which is here. Let me get a bit larger. You see, there is a solid web part sppkg is the package, basically SharePoint package. You will take, put in here, drag and drop, replace it. Doesn't hurt. And then deploy. So it's as simple as that. Once the application is built, you can just drag and drop employ. Done. Done. That was quick. Excellent. And then you can use it. So then in popular quotes, hopefully this time it works. No, it doesn't, because I keep on forgetting on running. I don't know, I did. I was in the right folder now, yes. And now it's taking the quotes from the real SharePoint list. So that's it, basically. It was very simple, but just to give you an idea of the how to try to be solid. And obviously, no, in the time that we have, it's a bit difficult to go through through the different cases. And I want to give some time for a few questions. And I said all the source code for this web part is on my GitHub repository, so feel free to play with it. There is more that you can gain from looking at the code rather than just me talking over time. Any question? Question there.
Hello. My name is Alexander. I have two questions. First one, if you use packages and consider the situation when you have two web parts that should use this, must use some common code base. I mean, for example,
you can use a common library. You mean?
Common layer, I mean, for example, that consumes some REST or whatever. Will you pack this functionality to every web part?
Yes, you have to do that. You can create this common code separately as a TypeScript library, but then for each web part, you have to reference. And referencing TypeScript is super simple. You only do like this at the top, import the name of the class from name of the file, and that's it. So you create your library, and then you can reference this library in every solution, in every web part. Yep.
Okay, and next question is about provisioning. What provisioning ways are supported by this new framework?
Provisioning?
I mean site provisioning.
Site provisioning, yes. None at the moment. This is a page and web part framework. So you can create pages, or you can create web parts, but not sites and not list, at least for now. So for now is pages and web parts. Okay. Probably in the roadmap they will add more things in the future.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
So we have time for one more question.
Okay.
Do we have? No. Okay then, looks like no. So thank you very much
All
for
right,
the presentation.
All right, excellent.
Yeah, it was very interesting. Thank you.